kitchen to forget them. Switch them all on.
A mirage brought on by your terrible thirst. Come up, Napoleon.
Language and a people who've recognized some kind of God, but whether they get them converted to Christianity remains to be seen.
Judging by him, they have been.
Oh, whatever they are, I'm afraid they're not Church of England.
As the centenary of the cinema is being celebrated, more films are being produced in Ireland than ever before. This has not always been the case. Ireland, more than most European countries, has an uneven history of film production, with foreign producers making more feature films about the country than Irish filmmakers.
Market, 614, two common marker.
It is only recently that Irish filmmakers have begun to attract the attention of international commercial cinema audiences.
And the Oscar goes to Neil Jordan for The Crying Game.
Thank you. Thank you.
There seems to be periods of time in which the focus of energy gathers around a particular country, like Italy in the 40s or France in the 50s and early 60s, and then new German cinema. There are these periods of time where suddenly a lot seems to be happening.
I think the attraction of people to Irish movies is a bit like the attraction of people to South American fiction. You know, they see very strong, kind of direct, raw narrative, powerful narrative coming out of a country which is, you know, there's many aspects to it. It's not only it's half a contemporary culture, it's half part of the cosmopolitan world, and it's half rather bruised and rather unknowable at the same time, you know.
An Irish cinema has threatened to come into existence virtually in every decade since the foundation stage. In each case, just as it's about to get up on its feet, it's prevented from doing so and is deliberately handicapped. Now, for the first time, I think we are at a point where maybe it will gain continuity and could grow into the art form which it was always capable of.
Thank you.
Wicked.
Okay, you can go in now.
Can we go in?
No, wait your turn. You still hanging around.
My first memory is an aunt taking me to see in old Chicago. I really must have been, when I think about it, I must have been about 3 or 4. But I remember it. I remember the images of it. It was a Chicago fire, and that I was really very, very young.
Going to then the evening comedies, Humphrey Bogart in the Green Cinema. I saw all of Bogart's films in the Green Cinema for fourpence at the time. That was sixpence total, penny bus down, fourpence in, penny bus back.
Then the usual was, the gangster pictures. I was a big Western buff, you know. Loved the cowboys.
My father, for various reasons, thought movies were rather decadent. Things that were not of our culture, you know, so I was allowed to see them once every 2 weeks, basically. So I saw very few. The ones I saw, I had to see clandestinely.
I remember at one stage when I was in primary school, just about old enough to go into town on my own, where I would go in with friends of mine, and we'd sit in the Grafton Cinema, and we'd go not even knowing what was on. And we'd sit and we'd watch absolute trash, but it didn't matter so long as it was film. So I was hooked, you know, from a very young age.
The first regular cinema was the Volta. That was the one I was in. But there had been pictures here in the Rotunda. They were seasonal pictures by James T. Jemison, so they were a relation of the Whiskey Man.
Well,
but they used to have a seasonal show on in the Rotunda. But ours now, ours was the first regular cinema, and Joyce was the one who brought over these Italian.
James Joyce.
James Joyce. The kid himself, he's the one, but no, I didn't know who he was at the time. Didn't know that he was a literary man of any description.
Shortly after the first projected screens of films in Paris by the Lumiere brothers in 1895, Irish cinema audiences experienced with the same sense of wonder the cinematograph's world of movement. As was the case in many other countries, the Lumiere projectionists screened French actuality and made the first filmed images of the country. This view of O'Connell Street, Dublin, is the oldest known moving picture of the Irish capital. It was not until 1910 that fiction film production began in Ireland. But this pioneering effort was also left to foreign filmmakers. Sidney Alcott was a film director and actor of Irish descent, working for the Caleb Company, who came to Ireland from the USA to make what was promoted as the first fiction film made on two continents, Europe and America. Unsurprisingly, he chose a story of Irish migration as his first Irish film. A poor farm worker goes to New York, and having made his fortune there, arrives back in Ireland in time to save his girlfriend from eviction. The Colleen Bawn, like most of the other Caleb films, was made in County Kerry, with well-known tourist attractions such as the Lakes of Killarney used as location. They proved to be very popular with Irish audiences in America.
My name is Tyrone Power. I'm an actor and, praise God, of Irish descent. My family having come from Kilmacthomas in the county of Waterford. Well, some time ago, a group of friends of mine decided, for the first time, to make a major picture entirely in Ireland. Of course, I had to be one of that group. Now, as you know, Ireland is a quiet little island of about 4 million population, although there are tens of millions of people of Irish descent, like myself, scattered all over the world. So we made this little picture entirely in natural setting.
The film was The Rising of the Moon, also known as Three Leaves of a Shamrock, and the director was John Ford, the most prolific of Irish-American film directors. Ford filmed many Irish stories from the 1910s until the 1960s. only three of which were shot in Ireland.
You'll not put that coat in the good sand, Paddy Morrissey, that I'm telling you. There wouldn't be one egg left or a bit of produce.
5 years earlier, he had filmed The Quiet Man on location here. Like the rising of the moon, it combines that mixture of playfulness and seriousness, which is characteristic of Ford cinema. In this part of The Rising of the Moon, the departure of a train is repeatedly delayed for increasingly eccentric reasons.
I say, you can't put that animal in there!
No. This is your wedding day.
No.
But this is preposterous. I shall sue the railway company.
Your wedding day, a day as lovely as the song of the lark. Step this way, madam. Pay no attention to the smell of the paint. You'll get used to it in no time.
Hector, is this a first-class carriage?
Well, if you want it first class, you must have it first class. There you are, ma'am. Now they're all first class.
Ford had this tendency when he was operating in front of the Irish, I realize now, to be more Irish than they, and sometimes it could be quite embarrassing for the Irish viewer, for whose benefit he did these things.
My widow, I take the Patiganish, August.
I mean, there is truth in The Quiet Man as a film, but it's not the kind of truth we in Ireland would like to see. And we kind of condescend to it by saying, oh, The Quiet Man stereotype and all that, which it is. But it's actually, Ford looked upon himself as like the fella from Galway, you know, from Spiddle, who went over to America and was coming back giving everybody a bit of employment. And he was the big fella, I suppose, then. Can you just imagine what it was like? You know, in a very poverty-stricken culture, he's the big guy come back. And that's what John Wayne is. And John Wayne is coming away from the kind of violence of killing somebody in the ring to Ireland, and he gets caught up in this, you know, brawl thing. And it's kind of, I don't know, it's not too serious a film. It's kind of, but it's a good film. It wouldn't last this length if it wasn't.
Charge it!
I'll be going on home now. I'll have the supper ready for you.
Was only one of many American filmmakers who put Ireland on the screen. Occasionally, though, Americans in Ireland find that the Irish have a unique sense of geography, which leads in peculiar direction, as these travelers discover as they try to get to Shannon Airport.
Well, you stay here with the car in case someone comes along. I'll scout up the road a bit. Must lead somewhere.
Not too sure. Irish paths are whimsical, like the Irish character.
Most of Hollywood's Irish films deal with the experience of the Irish in America. One of the most popular of Irish-American genres was the nostalgic musical.
I landed here from Ireland just a week ago today, and as soon as I had settled in the town, I resolved to act entirely in a Yankee Doodle way. So I changed the name, but not the Emerald Gown. Then I strolled around to see the sights, assumed the Gibson air, but it really didn't seem to work somehow. You know, every Thomas, Dick, and Harry yells, "There's Tipperary Mary." So that is why I'm asking of you now.
Glory be to the old Irish!
How can they tell that my Irish man comes from the Emerald Isle? Can they tell it from his talk? Or perhaps they spot me by my Irish smile?
My memory of seeing cinema or images that I associated with Irish cinema
was really to do with, you know, watching films where people were doing very bad impressions of being Irish people and thinking that was funny, you know, thinking that was weird.
Not just women, but in terms of the way the North, for example, and Ireland in general was represented, like the way people were mythologized, the way forms of rational thinking were taken away, the way the North, for example, was seen as in the grip of these dark mythological forces, and the way it was never seen that people created these problems and that people could solve them.
It's all right, Johnny. I'm here.
Mrs. Farr.
It's a long way, Johnny, but I'm coming with you. We're going away together. Shoot you, Terry, and dump you in a bog. Wouldn't it be better to go out like that? With your head high and give your warm blood without fear in a great cause.
Blood. That's all ye want. That's all ye all want. You're like Ireland herself that keeps crying out always for blood and more blood. Wouldn't you think you'd be sick of it all? Wouldn't you think the whole wide earth would be vomiting blood from all the bright-eyed young fellows went out in their day? Mother of mercy, when will we all get sense?
I'm not going to fight your war!
Oferecimento Postos e Gasolina Val, para quem percebe a diferença.
Oi, querida.
Oi, querida. Que tal a novidade?
It wasn't until 1916 and the beginning of the third decade of the cinema in Ireland that the first major Irish fiction film company, the Film Company of Ireland, was formed. One of its major projects was this feature, set in the 18th century, which carried a powerful anti-sectarian message and was released on the fourth anniversary of the 1916 rising. The Film Company of Ireland also made contemporary dramas and comedies. These films featured Abbey Theatre players, including popular comedian Arthur Sinclair, seen here playing a father who risks the family home by gambling the rent money on the Irish Derby. From the 1920s onwards, filmmakers began to explore the legacy of the struggle for independence. Irish Destiny, made a few years after the Anglo-Irish War, dramatized thrilling events from that time, including the famous escape of 200 IRA prisoners from the Curra camp in 1921. Despite its low budget, The Dawn proved to be more popular with Irish audiences than contemporary foreign films about the same subject.
Well, I lived in Killarney all my life. And of course, very naturally, I selected it as the location for any film that I'd make, or that I'd consider making. And then the natural scenery was there, the backgrounds were there, and everything we needed was there, as far as they were available, useful to us.
A surprise rediscovery from the 1930s is the unreleased Some Say Chance. A middle-class Irish woman, played by Rita Fitzsimons, works as a prostitute in London as a means of supporting her daughter, who is attending boarding school in Ireland, after her husband deserts the family and goes to Australia. Made by novelist Michael Farrell, it was a daring subject in the socially conservative 1930s.
I know you, do I?
Irish filmmaking has not been well known for its comedies, but a Northern Ireland film producer, Donovan Peddlety, made comedies as well as dramas in the 30s, which featured singer Richard Hayward.
Somebody there, I know
of it. Let's go on. We've got to.
Can I go?
Don't know where that road leads to.
Where?
I'm sure this is the right way. I'm sure.
This way. This road. This will take me where I must go.
By the 1950s, indigenous fiction and documentary films were being produced with increasing regularity.
Look. There's someone might tell us if we're on the right road.
Rather than supporting these developments, state policy for film went down a cul-de-sac. The Irish government helped establish Ardmore Studios, but it was foreign producers who actually benefited.
Ardmore has been here now since 58, and it has cost over $1.5 million of state funds. It hasn't yet produced an Irish film. It hasn't produced an Irish filmmaker in the sense of a producer or a director or a cameraman or an editor or an art director. It can't ever produce these because it is a hireable facility, and the people who can afford to hire it, who are the foreign film companies, aren't there to prove that Irishmen can make films. They will want to use their own people on it always.
When Taoiseach Jack Lynch visited the set of Sinful Davy in 1967, Irish-American director John Huston, who had taken out Irish citizenship 4 years before, encouraged him to examine the feasibility of a film industry in Ireland. The government then set up a committee under the chairmanship of Huston, which endorsed state funding for film production. Much to the disappointment of Irish filmmakers, the report's recommendations were not implemented, while foreign film producers continued to use Ireland as a location and to make big-budget Irish stories.
I came here because we wanted a wild place, and I like wild places, and I think this west coast of Ireland is one of the most beautiful wild places I've ever seen.
The 1970s and 1980s saw new subjects and challenging film forms being explored by Irish filmmakers. These films examine some of the shibboleths of Irish culture and society. And while not often reaching wide audiences, they nevertheless provided important alternative screen images of the country.
There was more wealth, there was less immigration. We simply had choices people, our predecessors, didn't have. And we had this... it wasn't an easy choice. In other words, there wasn't a lot of finance available to make film, but there was at least the possibility of looking at your own society.
Camera! Light! Action!
Do you mind?
Yeah, good, governing Corino.
All right, everybody, make yourself comfortable. That's it. And we will all enjoy the first sight of our grand new ethnic Gaelic Technicolor epic. Here we go. Oh, kill the lights!
The three courses of Ireland. England, religion, and the drink.
We decided very early on that it couldn't actually be made in a kind of a three-act form that most fictional films about the north of Ireland were made in at that time. There was either panorama documentaries or else there were Wednesday plays, like sort of humanist visions of stoic people getting through the problems in the north of Ireland. different kinds of things we wanted to talk about couldn't fit easily within a three-act drama. So that really is why Maeve is in the form it's in.
First film I made was Angel, which was about, set in the north of Ireland, and it was about political murders, and you know, it was about a particular perspective on the whole issue of violence in the north of Ireland.
Who the fuck is she?
Doesn't matter who she is. John.
Why did you stay? Come on, come on. I'll help you.
He's been very roundly attacked for his interpretations of the North, but I don't feel as strongly about it as maybe a lot of people down here feel about his filmmaking, because I think that he maybe was only reflecting quite a commonly held point of view anyway when he talked about, he's talked in interviews about the North having, the problems in the North being rooted in a sort of psychic violence rather than looking at other rational explanations for why people behave the way they do. I think I concentrated on developing the story of one young girl, but we were always very clear that she was going to be set in the context of a town which had was experiencing the war. Her boyfriend was somebody who got involved in the fringes of republicanism and ended up in prison. Those were all elements which were brought into it and were clearly identified at the beginning as part of the story.
Wait. I think they're going now.
So that, you know, the fabric of everyday life for young people in the North was clearly illustrated.
I suppose it's different in the sense that it's not about the Troubles. And not about anything associated with the Troubles, but it is about the community. Two communities living side by side. It's a period piece, so it's easier to talk about sectarianism without the influence of the Troubles colouring it.
Like the buttons flying off the boy's tunic that morning.
Want to try both? Don't alert you.
No,
you just want to do the one.
Yeah, because there's a big jump there.
Okay, fine. When all of these films are shown, that the amount of people that want to go and see them or are really enthusiastic about them is always incredible, is even shocking to me.
The way they burst out in all directions was like...
And we forget that there is this hunger out there for to see mirror images of ourselves, or whatever you want to call it. It's surprising, but at the same time, it's more surprising that we haven't seen this for so many years.
The way they burst out in all directions was like...
I wanted to show a terrible bleakness, you know? And I didn't want it just to apply to the people in the setting where it was made, in Connemara. I think I want to say that we are a very callous people, or people are very callous.
Now, call your action, sister!
Oferecimento Fox.
Over the decades, many areas of Irish society hadn't been reflected on film. We were trying to bring in, from the margins, those different stories that hadn't been told, and put those stories on screen for the first time.
Like a song or a ballad, you know, the narrative is very, very simple, and the kind of things that happen in, I was interested in the kind of stories that could happen inside a single image, like the image at the beginning where the women stand up in the cart. And also it aims to show that she wasn't this sideline figure in the Romeo and Juliet story that was Robert Emmet and Sarah Curran, that she was a politicized woman.
These films had been the culmination of several decades of campaigning by Irish filmmakers for state support for film production. With the setting up in 1981 of a production fund administered by the Irish Film Board and the introduction of tax incentives for film in 1987, continuity of production was gradually established. The result is that the present filmmaking regime is the best so far in Ireland. It allows the small-scale film project to be produced while assisting Irish and foreign producers to make larger budget feature films. In 1990, Irish cinema reached a worldwide audience for the first time with the Oscar success of Jim Sheridan's My Left Foot.
The late hours of last night to the small hours of early morning, fans, friends, supporters and the other members of the cast of the Irish film My Left Foot had gathered in Ardmore Studios in anticipation of Oscar himself coming to Ireland. They didn't have to wait too long.
The Oscar goes to Brenda Fricker in My Left Foot.
As Brenda Fricker said, wouldn't it be nice to bring just one Oscar home to Ireland? Well, now, thanks to her and to Daniel Day-Lewis, two are winging the way to Ireland. And now here in Hollywood, it's party time for the Irish.
A funny thing about film is that far from it being like a very kind of sophisticated medium, I think it's the opposite. I think it returns you much more to the original and dramatic structures.
It was Mummy, wasn't it? I know she's gone home.
The travelers, cowboys, or Indians, Papa?
There's a bit of a travel on everybody, Tito. Very few of us know where we're going.
People who are operating in the institute at this point don't have a distinctive voice. I think there are many distinctive voices within that. So I don't think we're necessarily going to have a kind of a movement that we can look back on in years to time and in years to come and find that it is particularly distinctive or particularly similar. I think that there are key issues in terms of new Irish cinema and in terms of how that's going to develop, and there are a range of policies that have been put in place which have been incredibly helpful and incredibly useful, but there is the old problem of finding the rest of the money.
The ground was solid and as hard as stone underneath your feet. It was the kind of cold that wraps around you like a hand.
In terms of Paddy's approach to us, I think that when he was conceiving and shooting the film, his inspiration and his reference points were very much the Eastern European filmmakers, contemporary Eastern European filmmakers. We knew that we had a European art house movie on our hands. It certainly wasn't anything that owed a debt to any Irish cinema, although Paddy is a big fan of Neil Jordan, so I'm sure some of his influences have crept into the film.
Such a literary gutch as we do in Ireland, where everything seems to have been written about endlessly, but 25 different times, to be able to make a movie was like a whole new language, you know, to me.
Keep going. You're out, yeah? Now just send a horse forward and try and get it to Rare.
I gradually get to find, actually, that it's an international thing, filmmaking, you know. And the more films I've made, the more I realize that it's actually, its nationality is important in a personal kind of way, you know, in a way of the specific stimulus of a particular movie. But the way the industry is structured now, it's mainly dominated by America, you know.
Jack, what are you doing?
It's a little champagne to us. To Ireland. Your homeland. Loch Ness Monster. Guys in skirts.
That's Scotland, Jack.
I knew that. I knew that.
But I think every person who makes films now, unless they make very small independent films, they have to deal with Hollywood in some way or other. Every filmmaker who works internationally is a filmmaker who happens to be Irish, French, you know, Chinese, Hong Kong, or whatever, you know, because it's become this huge international thing, you know.
I suppose I'm a director who happens to be Irish, but you know, a lot of the time we ask all this question, Irish, 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 and it's a mantra of, to me, lack of self-possession and lack of self-centeredness, you know. It's kind of like, we're always trying to figure out who we are. You know, we're always trying to figure out our identity. Because somewhere really deep down where we feel maybe we don't have one.
18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18,
Jesus Christ. He's a brown. He's a brown, all right.
Christy's a brown.
Oh, where are you going, buddy?
What do you think? This man deserves a jar.
Ready? You come when you're ready.
I'm ready.
And Corbin.
Anything that I like, in other words, if the script, it doesn't have to be about Ireland, but it seems to be that that's the subject that I'm about, you know, and feel easier here, well, obviously we'll kind of drift it. But this picture of Frankie Scarlett was written by an American, and the book was an American novel. And it wasn't, the story could be set anywhere. New Orleans, it was going to be set in Paris at one stage, it was going to be set in London, then it was set in Cork. And then, of course, it was filmed in Dublin.
That's a wrap.
Thank you. Yeah.
And for Corbin. Yeah.
It's ridiculous that in four and a half, whatever it was, 1990, 4 years, that My Left Foot cost $2.5 million or $1.7 million. This film has cost over $7 million. And when you get into that range of expenditure, you cannot recoup it from here. So you have to kind of have an eye to the market.
It was more, I suppose, for me in truth, that the films were an extension of working in the theater. You know, I suppose just the truth of the matter is what got me into films was money. You know, I was broke in New York. I'd done theatre forever and ever. And I had to kind of find some way out of just being totally poverty stricken. Now, that was one side. The other was that I always wanted to do, you know, cinema. I don't know, just make films about stuff, you know. I suppose, if, you know, everybody denies all the things that are the actual truth, I think. You know, they all say, well, I wanted to prove this, that, or the other about Ireland or whatever. You know, I wanted all the vain things, you know. I wanted to make more money, and I wanted to be, you know, you can make a film, your name's up there, and you think, well, I've made one film, and now I can retire, you know. You know what I mean? You'll be remembered or something. All those are the actual reasons people do it, not for glorious reasons, I think.
We get
it. It sticks its neck out and sits its sweep from the heart. Sure, there's lots of music you can get off on, but soul is more than that. It takes you somewhere else. It grabs you by the balls and lifts you above the shine.
Said to the man at the railroad station, I want a ticket just for one. He said, well, if you insist, but where you wanna go,
I recall getting the morning off work and going in to see it in the Savoy Cinema, and after about 25 minutes really beginning to enjoy myself, I was very happy with it. I think it's a fuller film than the book. You know, the book is a small, slim book, and it's a very loud and a brash and anyway, 2 hours, quite a long film, I suppose. But I was very happy with it. Now and again, I think an outsider's view of Ireland crept in. There's a scene which a lot of people like, the young guy going to confession, and the priest actually, it turns out, has a greater knowledge of soul music than he does.
That's me, Father, for I have sinned. It's been a month since my last confession. I've been with this band. There's been a lot of cursing and blasphemy, and I've been neglecting my exams. And it's these three girls with the band. I've had lustful thoughts about all of them. And when in study they used to sing hymns. Now I'm always humming When a Man Loves a Woman by Marvin Gaye.
Percy Sledge.
Huh?
It was Percy Sledge did that particular song. I have the album.
Oh.
And while it's, the punchline is quite funny, it just struck a bad note with me for the simple reason that that boy wouldn't have gone to confession. I know, I come from here, and that guy would not have gone to confession. And that annoyed me slightly, and there were little patches that annoyed me a bit, but only tiny. It would be churlish of me to give out about them too much, because overall I was very, very happy with it.
I think it's a much tougher game than people think. I think it's, and not tough in the sense of that you have to be a tough guy, but you have to be smart.
I've been very lucky. I think from the writer's point of view, if you want to see your work eventually end up on the screen, more or less, or whatever, as you hear it in your head and perhaps see it in your head, really, the smaller the project in many ways, the better. It means that you'll never retire to Lake Como, or if you do, you'll have a tent. But it also means that you can withstand a lot of the pressures, the pressures that come with the big budget, or the pressures won't be there at all.
It just depends on how much you want to compromise, I suppose. The thing about Korea is that it's cost less than $500,000 to make. So I didn't have to compromise that much. I mean, there were enough pressures to try and get the film made within 30 days. And that was enough of a compromise. Thank you very much.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
The choices as to whether we become the consumer of images in a passive culture, or whether we will be allowed to be the makers of images in an active culture, in a democratic society. There is no way of evading that fundamental policy choice internationally. And there is a way out. It not achieved, I think myself, by simple exclusions, but by building up a base of productivity in images, and accepting one great and exciting fact, that it is in the interstices between cultures that some of the most exciting things happen. But you cannot get to that point of pluralism and international tolerance if you have first been dominated so completely that you have no space in the market.
We need film as part of the mechanism of keeping our society healthy. It's not some kind of side issue.
If there is to be any kind of healthy cinema at all, you need tiny movies, and you need expensive movies. You know, you need people who work in a big popular style, and people who work just totally out of their own aesthetic and instincts, you know.
I think there will be the odd lighthouse where somebody gets a film through that is, you know, strong and independent, in inverted commas, and says something real about our own situation.
I'm quite optimistic about it. I hope that's the case. I still think we need a hell of a lot more resources, and we do need the support of a continuing government policy to help filmmakers.
I think Irish cinema being emerging at this kind of late stage, it's got a very, it's in a very peculiar position, you know, because what happens to young filmmakers now, if they're successful, is they're propelled straight into the limelight, you know, and they're kind of pushed straight into this, basically what's a world distribution system, really, which has never been there before, and it's kind of nerve-wracking time, but it's, for people who want to grab it, it's quite exciting.